It was just so funny. My first impression was, oh my gosh, his last name is Lord. He seems like he's going to be very serious.
I would have been scary. The Lord of Admissions.
We Are Warrington is a new podcast that helps young business leaders discover what is possible by highlighting stories from the Warrington College of Business community about the University of Florida experience, business industry insights, innovative research, and more. I'm your host, Andy Lord. Today we are speaking with Rachelle Antoine, a full-time MBA student at the Warrington College of Business. Rachelle came to UF MBA seeking a career change from the customer service industry. Is that correct, Rachelle? Were you in the customer service industry?
No, that's pretty right. I mean, I did a lot of different things, but yes.
As far as I remember, I think you were working at a bank at a point in time when we met you.
Wells Fargo.
Gotcha. Well, how are you doing today, Rachelle?
I'm doing well today. It's finals week. I'm almost done with classes. I'm going out of town next week, so good things are coming.
Gotcha. Where are you heading next week?
We headed to Georgia. I wish I knew what area. I just had my friends, we booked a place. We're all going to get tested and then we're going to go. So
that sounds like fun. So you've been getting out a little bit here during this part, or I guess in this time of COVID-19?
Honestly, this is the first like big one I've done. I went down to see family a little bit this weekend. And then before that, not really. Most of my roommates, the biggest thing we do in Gainesville is go for walks. So we're not doing much. And so I love going somewhere. I miss going outside. So yeah.
I understand that completely. So Rachelle, what do you like to do when you're hanging out in Gainesville when times are normal?
Oh, there's so many things. First, probably dancing. I love to dance. So downtown Palomino's, honestly, anywhere that where there's dancing, I'll be there. Love hanging out with my MBA friends. We do a lot of different things. So one of the things we do is story slam. So I'm an artist, a spoken word artist. And so I like to write poems and perform for friends or different organizations. I like to sing. So I sing and play on the guitar. I'll make music, but I can't get past the chorus. So that's usually as far as I go. But yeah, that's a little bit of like me. I'm kind of like an artistic person and anything outdoors. So like I love going to Depot Park. Love doing some walks or runs and stuff like that with friends. So, yeah.
Awesome. I know you're a returning Gator. You did your undergraduate degree here as well. Tell us about you graduated. What did you do after graduation when you left the University of Florida? And what was your degree in again?
So I graduated in 2014 and I graduated with a degree in family, youth and community sciences, which is a mouthful, and a minor in nonprofit leadership. And crazily enough, 3 months after I graduated, I moved to Colorado. And so that was kind of to work. My whole goal was to really work in the nonprofit space. Part-time on my own side gig, I helped start a church plant. But in my own world, I worked as a teacher for about a year, which I enjoyed. It was a nonprofit school. So we got to help a lot of different families who probably couldn't afford it before. I also, after that, realized, okay, I love the kiddos, but don't want to do this like for full time. So I kind of progressed. I went to a property management company, wanted to gain some administrative skills so I could work in one of my favorite nonprofits in the area called the Family Intercultural Center at the time in Colorado. And I was in a small town in Colorado in the mountains, which was awesome, in the Rocky Mountains called Frisco. And I then like my life kind of changed when I had like a mentor who was into finance. He was an investor. He was going to like retire when he was 45. And so I said to myself, I was like, okay, I'm going to like learn from him. He went to my church. And that's kind of where I started with towards finance. And so the reason I got to Wells Fargo was kind of like wanting to go up my career, accelerate my career. Did that for about 2.5 years, kind of started over, and then realized it'd probably be quicker to get my MBA to do it that way.
So what made you look back at the University of Florida towards your MBA? What were you thinking at that point in time?
Yeah, I think this is like January. So I'd already had plans, January 2018, I'd already had plans to move to Florida. And so I was looking at programs and researching them. And I went on to a programs call. So UF had always been like in the back of my mind, but I didn't know for sure if I would go back or not. I did an online service, program we had for it just to let us know about the program. And then they talked about it. It sounded really cool. But then the free tuition really like, I was like, wait, it's free? And I remember asking a question. I was like, wait, what do you mean? Like for students, like, what do you have to do? She's like, no, in 2018, it starts. And that really changed my mind. And then I started to get that really like, I think drew my attention. Then I had a couple calls with Jeff, asked him a lot of questions about job search, because I was really big on I wanted a master's degree, like getting my MBA would be huge, but I knew that for me, I didn't want to just get a master's. I wanted to get a master's that mattered in terms of a job. Like, so I asked them a lot of questions about career and how they prepared you for the career. And I was really surprised by like just how well-versed UF was. They're highly ranked in terms of career services and job placements and the salary. So I was a happy camper after that.
Well, that's great. It's great to hear. So you've been involved for quite a while. I know you do a lot outside of the classroom. And I think for our listeners here, UF is about the education. It's about the resources that are tied to it itself. But how about that student experience? Can you elaborate a little bit more about what it's been like over the course of your 2 years since you've been here with us?
Of course. Oh, man, I was super surprised. And I said this because when I thought of getting a master's, I did not think it was going to be fun. Like, to be honest, I just didn't think business school was going to be as exciting. But I think one of the things that surprised me was the people. And so one thing I say this to my friends all the time is, you know, every MBA has a high caliber, for the most part, at least of the top ranked, UF is top ranked school, has really high caliber students, right? We're specifically selective, like you have to pass the GMAT, you have to go through rigorous interviews. So you have to be a selective student. But I think what made UF stand out to me, I think in meeting the people, was that UF recruited kindness. And I just think that is so interesting. I didn't expect everyone to be so nice and helpful, especially people from so many diverse backgrounds. And so for me, that was the biggest surprise. In terms of just like student involvement, I think one of the things that, one, the organic stuff, I can't say that enough. The people are my favorite. Like, I feel like I made friends for life here. Like, not just people that I'm like, cool, they're my classmates and like I'll be done with them after I graduate, but people like my two roommates Beck and Hannah, I love them. Like, our classes, they call our class the cuddly cohort because we're always hanging out, we're always chatting. So like, that was one of the things I loved. In terms of involvement, things that I've loved, I love diversity initiatives. So I love being involved in our diversity recruiting, in being able to talk to different students from different backgrounds, whether it's like veterans, whether it's women or people of color. So I thought that was exciting. Me getting involved in case competitions, that was an experience. Really, like putting your whole full time, getting that prep. It was insane. But I did one in Tennessee last year for Vanderbilt with some friends. So that was really cool, really practical experience too.
Wonderful. Clearly, you're an ambassador. I know you've been working with the admissions team on some of the initiatives that we're putting into place. Is there anything that you could tell us about that, what it's been like working with Jeff Danzo, who works in admissions, and some of the things we're trying to do in UF MBA?
I think I'm a natural recruiter. Like, anything that I love, I'm going to tell a lot of people about it. And so I remember talking to Jeff, like, hey, if you do anything, like, let me know. And the year I came in, Vlad was that they were planning that first diversity recruitment weekend. And I'm like, please let me get involved because I was an ambassador. And so I think for me being a part of that, I got to talk to so many students. And I think a lot of the students had imposter syndrome. They're like, I don't know if I could do this. I don't know if I could apply. And I think one of the things I loved was like telling them, no, you're here. Like, we chose you for a reason. Like, you have the qualifications. Like, I will help you if you need anything, help with the interviews or anything like that. Like, that to me was huge because it just made me realize how there's a need for diversity students, whether it's women, whether it's people of color, whether it's veterans, to feel like, hey, you got this, you can do this. Because if you're coming from a different background without any business, it could feel, I think, intimidating sometimes going to business school. So I think I've been really impressed by that. And just like, I've also worked with Jeff on Jumpstart Initiative. So me and Jeff have done some presentations together where we were able to show kind of students the kind of like why UF is worth it, why the MBA is worth it. And so I've gotten to show people, hey, here's why I think it's worth it for me as a student. Because I think a lot of times why people of color don't go to business schools, because taking off 2 years of school sounds crazy. And you have to see what's the ROI on that. So I'd say that's definitely one of the things that I love doing and love telling. And I've gotten a lot of good feedback from students on LinkedIn after we've connected, so.
Gotcha. Last summer, you did your internship at Owens Corning, correct? What was your location and what were you doing over that internship?
So I actually was remote because of the whole, you know, COVID.
Right.
But my internship, so I was focused on marketing, but my project was, I was in the roof, one of their three businesses, I was in roofing. And my question was, okay, how do we win with Hispanic contractors? They have like 20,000 contractors in their base and they get a portion of the money from I think their contractor network. And so it's like, how do we win with them? What's the go-to-market strategy? Can you do a market size of what the actual market is worth? And then what do we do once we get there? And so it was an interesting project. And imagine it was in 8 weeks. So it was supposed to be 12, got condensed to 8 weeks. And I think for me, you know, I've never had marketing experience before. I've never like done this. And it's a huge, they're giving me a ton of responsibility. Like these markets, it's like a $2 billion business on its own. And so that was quite the experience. I honestly just hit the ground running. I met with so many people, try to get a feel of like what the business is like. And then I think a week before my project, so I did some analysis. I worked with a lot of marketers. I worked with like, I think I did like 30 plus interviews over the summer. And I was able to come up with a strategy, come up about with a market size tool through Excel. And I was able to present, but then 7 days before my presentation, my project kind of changed a little bit. And so, I mean, that, and it's super crazy because it's like, what's great about that is like, that's business. Things may change like very quickly. And so having to change that story, change that presentation, was able to work with my managers really well, and then was able to present. And I got really good feedback. Like it was, I wondered how it would be to present, you know, virtually, like from my house in my living room. But I think it went really well. There was over 50 people on the call, including VPs and like, I think other leaders in the group. And yeah, I was able to get an offer, which made me feel extremely happy and very proud of myself because it was a crazy summer, but it was really, really good experience. And it made me feel like I see why they prepared us the way they did, like in the fall and the spring. I feel like, okay, I can do this. You know, it just kind of solidified that.
Gotcha. That's great to hear. Let's reverse the clock a little bit. So I know when you came into UF MBA, you might have had one idea in mind, and I think you were pushing finance, you know, as your concentration. As you know, we have seven tracks at this point as far as our concentrations go. It looks like you took the jump over to marketing. Did that happen before the internship, or was this clearly after, or how did you make up your mind at that point in time? And maybe you can talk about the resources that helped you guide you down that path and what led you to becoming a marketing concentration.
Yeah, I definitely came in finance heavy. That was like what I wanted to do. I didn't really know what finance was completely about. I knew a little bit and I was like, okay, I'm going to go towards this. I think what made me start changing. So my process was, okay, I'm going to go towards finance. Probably 80 to 90% of what I applied for was finance jobs. And then the last 10%, I left open for like sales, marketing, and LDPs, like general leadership development programs, just to see. And I'm really glad that I did that because that's what opened the door for marketing. But along the way, as I was like interviewing for like finance jobs, I had talked to a lot of different alumni. One thing I loved about our program is that you get to connect with a lot of leaders. And so I was looking at Johnson & Johnson, their finance LDP. And I spoke to one of the guys and through our chat, he was a huge influence on me on changing my mind. Cause he's like, you know, I'm someone who I wanted to work with collaboratively across teams. I had a great time at my J&J Vision. He got the offer, but then he ended up not liking the actual day-to-day work. And I asked him his reasoning why. And he just said like, you know, I'm more of a people person. I like to collaborate across teams and I want to push the strategy. Very similar to me. I'm a people person. I want to lead a business. I want to be pushing the strategy behind it. Not that finance can't do that, but in that specific role. I started to think more about like, what are some of those roles that lead to there? I talked to a lot of friends, honestly, because they knew me. They knew who I was. I'm like, I remember asking Chelsea Creech. I said, hey, what do you see me in? And I'm like, don't think about like my current concentration of finance. What do you see me in? She's like marketing or sales. And so that was like, okay. And then I had other conversations, I think with Roger, another student. I think probably spoke to a ton of people from alumni to career coaches to friends in the program. And that helped me like, and also when I took finance, that was like the final knock on the door. When I took finance, I was like, okay, I started questioning. But then, so I had gotten early in the year after National Black, I had gotten an offer from ENJ Gallo for the finance program. And I was happy about that, but I kept recruiting and I got an internship currently in the role for Owens Corning. And I just thought it was a general LDP, had no idea it had anything to do with marketing. I actually didn't think it was marketing until the third interview. It was kind of funny because it showed like where my strengths were. And after being there, I didn't think I was going to say yes to them. I was super happy with ENJ Gallo and I was going to say yes to them. Just kind of wanted to get the offer just to have some competition in there in my offers. But they really changed my mind in the way that the people were amazing, the projects were challenging, it was fun, and they kind of won me over. So that's kind of like that weird. I ended up deciding in my offers, it was finance and marketing. And just because of the challenge and the enjoyment of the projects that I liked so far, I chose Owens Corning. So that's kind of how that process went. It was kind of figuring it out, taking finance, I think solidified the final round. But before that, it was the conversations. It was not knowing I was doing a marketing. I was applying for a marketing internship that opened up that door. That's kind of what led me there. And then after taking marketing in the spring, it solidified that, yeah, this is for me. Even like working the summer proved like, yeah, I definitely want to be in the marketing field.
I gotcha. You know, a lot of people say, you know, that come from, let's say, undergraduate degrees, that maybe not a lot of math was involved so much. What would you say to somebody that doesn't really have the strongest quantitative background as far as their, you know, pre-academics go?
Even though I went the finance route, it's not because I feel like I was super quantitatively strong. I mean, I was able to make it, obviously. But I think for the students who don't have that background, do it. Like, I say, like, if you don't know until you try. And I think a lot of, like, everyone knows, like, even when you're in the program, they know that people are coming from backgrounds that do not have previous accounting or previous knowledge in these areas. So they're going to work with you. Like, I've worked with professors and I'm like, I don't know about this. Like, when it came to finance and I talked to banker, I'm like, I don't know, I'm gonna do this, you know? And I was able to pull it out. And every semester, there might be calls I'm like, I don't know. And then I get through it. So I would say go for it. Like, don't let that stop you. Because if you're willing to put the time and the effort to practice, and like, I think one of the things that helped me a lot was I asked students for help. And I used to, in undergrad, I used to be like not for group study groups because I felt like they never led to any success or they didn't really do anything. But because of the high caliber of students, because students want to do well and like work hard, my group like study sessions were the best thing. They helped me so much, especially my finance, my quant background ones, you know, being able to study with friends who have been in finance, you know, who have worked for hedge funds or who have worked for as financial advisors were huge to my success as a student. So I would say, don't let that stop you. I'm one of those students who was definitely worried about the quant background and like, can I do this? But that first mod really shows you. I mean, you're taking quantitative modeling and like you go in like, how in the world am I going to do this? And you come out like, oh, I just did it. So
wonderful. Let's talk about the curriculum that prepares you guys, faculty. Can you share any experiences, maybe from a favorite class or material that you're learning that's highly influencing you and maybe changing the way that you look at the world?
And there, I'd say there are two professors that probably were my favorite. So first, in UF, they really front load a lot of things. So, you know, you're taking your accounting, taking finance, a lot of the heavy things in the beginning, which I appreciate because this year is a little, you have a little more freedom this year in terms of electives. So the first year I took accounting and I was nervous because I had never taken accounting and I'm like, oh my goodness, am I gonna be able to do this? And our professor Madsen, he was one, so passionate about accounting, which is not something I feel like you hear a lot of. And then two, he really made it fun. So like we played even this for group projects. We played Monopoly, I think, for one of the games. And we had to like fill out our accounting sheets through it. And I was like, this is like fill out financial statements, fill out everything. And I was like, this is accounting. And it just made it, I don't know, just very practical for me, but also in a fun way. Also, it allowed us MBAs to be competitive with each other, which was great. So you got to trash talk people. He just made me understand it and like it. I didn't leave hating it.
Right.
That was like huge. I was actually really free. And then two, I think Dr. Yang Yang's class for product development. I told myself even before taking the class, I'm like, oh, I think this will be interesting. I think I might be involved in want to be in innovation or product development. After taking her class, it was just like one, so eye-opening. It was interesting. And then like even this summer, just applying some of the skills that she told us, like different things about blue ocean strategy, looking across like consumers that are near non-consumers. So like when we looked at like the Hispanic market, trying to see like, okay, where are they that we're not reaching them? What are other markets doing that are not even in our business? So I looked at like, I remember looking at McDonald's or other companies that were doing well with Hispanics. So like a lot of the things that she taught me in her class, I applied even in my summer project. And so yeah, a lot of those classes were actually really practical when you did them.
That's great to hear. Let's talk about the resources, those that support you while you're in the program, from the curriculum, the academic advising side, and then something that I love to hang our hat on, which is our career services office and the help and the preparation, you know, with our MBA students. Could you speak to that a little bit?
Of course. So, man, I was so shocked at how much I had to learn coming in. I think I was surprised at how the business career services really prepares you for the job search. And, you know, you talk about the business career services, it's huge. I think in other, a lot, I don't know how it is in other programs or schools, but I loved ours because they took a fine tooth comb through my resume, right? Like, we had so much prep, and us being a small program, I got a lot of focused attention. So, you know, I met with Carly and we had like, okay, what do you want to do? What are you looking for? How do we prepare your resume? And then we did mock interviews, getting our star stories, even between friends within the classroom, because it was such a serious thing, right? It was like, hey, we hit the ground running to get ready for National Black, which was like the kickoff of recruiting. So they really it's like a pressure cooker. I feel like they kind of put us in of like getting ready for interviews, and you are like, you shine. And I think right this year I'm a CAP mentor, which is a career and peer mentor. So I have like 40 graduate students under me. And that like first year of learning all those career like stories, like I learned like there's a process to getting a job, like there's a process to standing out when it comes to applying. And I didn't know this previously. Like, I've told everyone about this, like I said, I'm a natural salesperson, I think, and just telling people what I love. And like I've helped my brother with his resume, I've told my friends about it, I've helped my CAP mentors prepare their resume, and they're like, where did you learn this? I was like, MBA, they really get you ready. So I would say it is top tier, like, because I felt like when I went into interviews and when I went into like, let's say National Black last year, or just in the recruiting process, so much more solid.
Thanks, Rachelle. That's great to hear. We're going to go ahead and take an ad break, and we'll be right back with you shortly. The UF MBA full-time program is ready to provide you with an immersive experience that can help you reach your professional goals. Ranked as a top 10 public program by The Economist, Financial Times, and U.S. News & World Report, you'll benefit from being more than just a number. Our small cohorts allow you to build meaningful relationships with classmates and have a jump start on building your network. With scholarships available for up to 100% tuition, you'll see why our program was ranked number 2 in return on investment by U.S. News & World Report. Learn more about how you can have access to the same benefits that help Rachelle thrive in the program by requesting information at the link in the podcast episode description or at www.warrington.ufl.edu/podcast/episode2. Again, it's www.warrington.ufl.edu/podcast/episode2. Okay, we're back. I'm here with Rachelle Antoine, a UF MBA student. Rachelle, just digging back into your UF MBA experience, maybe you could speak to what you want to leave as your legacy, or what has your impact been like here on UF MBA?
I think for me, when I think about like the impact I want to leave, you know, coming to business school was such a new experience for me. So I'm a Black, for those who don't know or hearing, I'm also Haitian. My parents were born in Haiti and came to the States a little later. And for me, there are very few Black students just across the board in business schools. And I think one of the things that was really huge to me was, oh, wow, business school has opened such a door for me. I want to bring people of color into that mix. So that was my whole thing about like, that's why I wanted to get involved and have gotten involved with diversity initiatives and Jumpstart. And that's why for me personally, like as a Black person in the UF MBA program, and kind of gleaning from what I learned in Colorado, I was, you know, in the mountains, I was one of the few Black people who lived there. I learned that like, okay, if I'm the only Black person that someone sees, I want them to understand my experience. I want them to understand what it's like to be Black in America. And that is hard, right? Like, especially if you don't have a lot of space. So in this program, I feel like I've had the opportunity to own my Blackness, right? And to show people like, hey, like I'm Black and I'm owning that, right? Like when, you know, a lot of Black Lives Matter and things were happening, I spoke with students, and honestly, what was super encouraging to me was a lot of students reached out to me to have conversations. And to me, that was my favorite thing. Like if that's the impact, I think the legacy I want to leave is let's have conversations, because I think when you think about like Black Lives Matter and people of color. On social media, everyone can be loud and really strong and proud and everything like that. But it's hard when it comes to everyday environments. And so being able to have conversations, real conversations with someone that you know, that we can both be respectful, but we can also realize this is a big issue, right? Like racism is a thing, like systematic racism is a thing. And I think most people know me as this anyways. You will see me, I'm really tall and I'm also loud and I'm Black. So like, I think I'm all those things. And so I want people to know who I am, but I also want people to have like break the stereotypes of what people think of Black people based on what they see on TV or anything like that, but also just opening this conversation. So I'd say that's the legacy I want to leave. And I've tried to do that with every conversation I have. I try to get as many people of color to the program as I can. So that's kind of the impact I'd love to leave.
Thank you for sharing, Rachelle. That really does mean a lot, and that definitely opens up eyes on people like myself and those that are around us, you know, on campus, looking to really do a little bit more outreach and change the profile of our programs across the board. So it is an exciting time for voices like yours to be heard. And we're definitely supportive of everything that you stand for and where you're leading us, for sure. For other students that are following in your footsteps, what advice would you give to a future UF MBA student or a future MBA student across the board? Any kind of insight, knowledge, little things that you've picked up that you're excited to share with maybe those that are going to walk behind you and as you lead them?
Man, I think take networking like seriously, and not seriously in the boring way, but like take it seriously and have fun and meet people. Like I think a lot of times, like I think some of the best conversations I've had have been in interviews where I may not have gotten the interview, or I didn't get that interview that well, but I made a connection for next year. So this happened a lot last year. I made a connection. I remember I was in South Florida. I was at Goldman Sachs. It was like 15 or 16 students. And that was when I was looking into the finance area. And a UF MBA walked right up to me and he was like, hey, he walked to no one else. He's like, hey, you're UF MBA. I'm UF MBA. I graduated this year. If you want a job in South Florida, I will help you. And like gave me his card. And I was like, wow, still have his card to this day. And this year, even though I didn't go to finance, I was able to pass his information to other UF MBA students. Like I had someone from Exxon last year who said, hey, Rachelle, like, I think you need to go get more finance experience if you're going to go, but I love you. And I think you're an amazing person. Come back next year and I will hire you. And so like just stuff like that, where sometimes it doesn't go the way you want, or it may go the way you want. Either way, like trying to really make real connections is the best way to get a job. And so for me, I said like take networking seriously in terms of like try to learn people and be curious. So like don't just try to learn them like as a transactional way, but really try to make a friend, because you never know, that person can be a mentor. I met someone from Disney. I was one of the speakers at the moderators at Professional Development Day. And I got to talk with the moderators. That's the reason I wanted to moderate, was I got to talk to the speakers. And she's like a mentor for me now. She's like, anytime you need help in the marketing field, I'd help. So networking is huge. And really follow what BCS tells you to do. So I know that it's like, okay, whatever. But like, seriously, like the mock interviews, the having your stories ready to go, researching the company, like all the things that they're telling you to do. Recruiting is a lot of work and it's a lot of like, can be a lot of pressure, but like taking the time to really craft out those stories, taking the time to really meet with your career advisor and see what you want, taking the time to apply, and follow through on what they're saying is super important. And I think because they're there for your success as well. So I think that was like super huge for me. And make friends. Don't forget to make friends. I've made the best friends, favorite thing in the program. It obviously is about a career, but like to me, having friends, I have friends like after I graduate school, I'll have friends in P&G, I'll have friends at General Mills, I'll have friends across the board. And who knows, we can help each other. If they need a job at Owens Corning, I might be able to help them. If they need a job, if I need a job one day, they might help me in the future. Or if we want to start a company together, you always hear about friends like coming up with business propositions together. So I think you definitely make connections and don't make it about just coming in and leaving, but connecting with the students around you is huge. So that's my advice.
Don't be a wallflower. It sounds like that's what you're saying. Rachelle, we've talked a lot about you spending time in this MBA program and the amount of time it takes to get through an MBA program, but many folks outside of a classroom are investing in themselves. Personally, what are you doing to invest in yourself beyond the classroom?
So I would say one of the first ways I invest in myself, which I think a little bit might be counterintuitive, is first by resting. So I realized, like, if I try to work 7 days a week and try to keep myself always busy, it's not the most productive for me. So the thing that I do to invest in myself is one, rest, which sounds counterintuitive, but it really helps me take my time. So when I'm working, I'm fully there 100%. And then when I'm not, I have time to really breathe, to really think. And then secondly, I love reading different books. And so I have audiobooks because they're the most efficient. So if I'm on a long drive, one of the books I'm reading now or through audiobook is How Brands Grow. Someone recommended that to me and I love it. And so for me, really keeping audiobooks on, I love podcasts. I don't know, all those things. So those are kind of my top things that I do to get information and invest in myself.
Gotcha. So when you say you rest, so what does that mean? Are you taking a cat nap or are you talking about like I'm taking a full 12-hour nap because that's it, I'm done?
No, that's actually a good point. So I figured out my rest system. So I think a lot of people, when they hear rest, they're like, hey, you just do nothing. But actually rest for me is filling if I do the things that I love. So a perfect rest day for me would be, you know, I would wake up late, probably 9 or 10. I'd make myself breakfast. If I was by a beach, is what I used to do in West Palm, I'd go to the beach in the morning. I would go to a gallery and walk around and browse it. I love museums. Then I would journal, maybe write a spoken word, do some poetry. And by 6, the end of the day, I might read a book as well. But by 6, then I'd hang out with friends.
That's
like my perfect rest day.
So obviously no MBA coursework is what you're saying there.
So it's interesting because, I do all the things that I love, like spoken word, or I write, or I look at poetry, but those things really help me like creatively solve problems. Spoken word helps me with writing and presenting, communicating. So I feel like I'm doing creativity on the other side of my brain so that when I go back to business school, it helps it in the other side.
I love it. That makes so much sense. So what do you do to stay motivated, Rachelle?
Well, I work out.
Nice.
So, yeah, for me, I wouldn't say like I work out like hardcore. I have really awesome roommates who are with me. And so they are either runners and they go to the gym all the time. For me, I'm more of the low-key one, but I would say I dance a lot. Dancing keeps me happy. Especially when things are not going right.
Yes.
I started this trend when quarantine happened where I would go on a walk. I call it my dance walk. It's super interesting. But basically, I walk down and I start dancing. if I want, I have headphones on, I have my dance playlist, and I start walking. If I hear a good jam, I start dancing no matter who's watching, and I keep going. And there's just a freedom to be able to do that outside and not really caring. And it's been really fun. I've had a lot of awesome honks or friends see me, and it's awesome. So it's like really a lot of fun.
That's awesome. Well, thanks for sharing, Rachelle. I have to ask you, what's your spirit animal?
Ooh, my spirit animal? Okay, the number one thing came up to mind immediately was a white tiger. And I'll explain this. So
okay.
A white tiger, because a white tiger is super unique. It's different.
Right.
But it's also beautiful and strong. So this is like a powerful animal, like it's majestic. So I think that is someone I want to be. I want to be a beautiful, kind being. I want to stand out, but I think I also want to be seen as someone who's strong, who can stand by what she believes in, can make good decisions, and change the world, really. So that's kind of my spirit animal, I think, or I'd like to be.
Love it. I know we're coming to our wrap up here, so I did want to ask you, what's your future look like now? You're graduating the program here soon. You don't have to let the cat out of the bag. I know you have some choices ahead of you that you have to make, which is great. You know, we want our students to have a ton of options whenever they're getting out of our program. Do you want to maybe share with our audience what it looks like for you?
So right now, I probably in the next month or so, I'll make a decision about where I'm going. But either way, like all like the offers, the opportunities I've gotten from the getting my MBA from UF has been like priceless. Like if you look at like, gosh, where I was last year and working and not liking my job before getting into business school to where I am now and having all these career opportunities and having like all the learnings that I just learned from like from the class learning, from just like learning how to stand up for myself, be confident and like own who I am. I've learned so much. And so for me, I'm really excited. I'm excited to be a leader. And like my future goals are to be hopefully a VP in a company. And so hopefully you'll see me as a VP in in the next coming couple years now, or maybe like 10 years. I'm not sure what the time frame is, but yeah, that's kind of how it looks like for me right now.
Go Gators.
Go Gators.
Go Gators. Rachelle, it's been an absolute pleasure talking with you today, and thank you so much for all of your insight of what it's truly like to be a UF MBA student.
Of course. I'm so happy to be here. Be a Gator, guys. This is awesome. So thanks for the experience. I appreciate it, Andy.
Great. Thank you so much. And thank all of you for listening to We Are Warrington. You can keep up with all things Warrington in the Warrington Newsroom and on social media at UF Warrington. See you next time. Stay motivated and keep investing in yourself.